Good morning. Buenos dias. How's everyone here today?
Good.
Good. Thanks for coming out. My name is Eric Swenson. I'm the mayor of Woodburn, and it's a pleasure to welcome you all here to Valor Middle School. Just inside this gym, my wife, Alejandra Mandujano Clements, teaches PE every day, and my son went to the school, now at the high school. So it's a pleasure to be here. I would like to start by introducing some of our elected officials. And so I'm going to start with Linda Reeves. She's the chair of the Woodburn School Board. Her husband is our superintendent. Lynn was the superintendent of the North Marion School District and is now serving on our school board. And a quick announcement, just on Thursday we hired Oscar Moreno Gilson to be Woodburn's next superintendent. So we're feeling very good about that. He's an assistant superintendent currently in the Portland Public Schools. Also, my good friend and cuate, Roland Herrera, Kaiser City Councilor, Woodburn High School graduate. And before my next introduction, I you're all here to hear United States Senator Merkley, who began as a state representative in Oregon. And so I am very proud to present not only our current state representative, but if you can make the connection, people become state representatives and then United States senators. So please welcome Teresa Alonso León, our state representative and future United States senator. So I've already signed up for that campaign. Already made my donation to that campaign. During his service as state representative and as our United States senator, Jeff Merkley has emphasized fighting for the success of Oregon's working families. That means fighting for good-paying jobs, strong public schools, and affordable college and health care. Just last year, he used his position on the Senate Appropriations Committee to secure more than $2 billion for affordable housing and homelessness services. He's also taken a number of actions to help the region's wine growers, including securing disaster relief for wine growers affected by wildfire smoke and funding research into the impacts of smoke on wine grapes so we can respond more effectively in the future. You know that Senator Merkley was considering a run for president, and I'm sure he would have the votes right here. By the way, that's turned out. I'm also signing up for that campaign if that happens again. And particularly to Woodburn, I've been a middle school and high school principal here and have worked with all the hardworking families. And it was such a heartwarming experience for our residents during the heart-wrenching time when so many of family members of even people in Woodburn were being detained in detention centers in Walmarts in Texas. And to have our United States senators stand in front of that Walmart and broadcast to the world what was happening, you have the eternal great gratitude of our community. Senator Merkley is a native Oregonian and the son of a millwright. He was born in Myrtle Creek, and his family moved with the timber economy to Roseburg and then to East Multnomah County. He was elected to the United States, or to the Oregon House of Representatives in 1998. In 2007, he became Speaker of the Oregon House and held that position until he was elected United States Senator. He began his involvement in policy as a young intern for Oregon Senator Mark Hatfield. And in 2009, he was sworn into the same Senate seat once held by Senator Hatfield. Senator Merkley holds an open town hall in every Oregon county every year. This is his 22nd town hall this year and his 418th overall. And we're very happy to have him. Please welcome your United States Senator, Jeff Merkley.
Well, greetings, everyone. Thank you so much for coming out today.
We have a much smaller turnout than usual. We normally completely fill this this room. And so we'll have a bit of conversation about the coronavirus and that challenge that represents. But before we do that, let's turn to putting a spotlight on something that has strengthened our community and our state. I try to do that at every town hall. And today I'm particularly pleased to shine light on the role that Willamette Valley Vineyards has played. And Jim Bernot is here. Am I pronouncing it right?
Yes.
Come on up, Jim. Come on up.
Oh, he's got a bottle of wine.
So we had a real challenge with the fires two summers ago. And those fires, the smoke from it, affected health around our state. It also affected many of our businesses. One business I met with was a furniture salesman, and their furniture, they had a real problem with getting the smoke smell out of the furniture. But think about how much of a challenge that is with wine grapes. Many of the buyers, significant buyers, canceled their orders at the last moment, even when the grapes weren't tainted. And this is where Jim stepped in. And why don't I have you tell a story?
Thank you, Senator. You know, it's not hard for us who make our living, at least at some time in our lives in agriculture, to imagine what happened in the Rogue Valley. Think about you growing your crop and putting all your savings and your money into growing that crop through the growing season, only to learn just a few days before your harvest that your grapes were not going to be accepted by the buyer. How are you going to pay your mortgage? How are you going to make sure you have the money for next season? That's the challenge that our growers faced. They didn't have insurance. And so when they reached out to us as winemakers here in the Willamette Valley, we banded together as an industry to see if we could help them. And even Senator Merkley's staff came down to help us pick the grapes, to save some of the grapes, as many grapes as we could. And we as winemakers, and imagine this, imagine, you know, think about winemakers and how headstrong they are. Imagine winemakers getting together to agree on making a wine together. It's like having, you know, four chefs in your kitchen with all the sharp knives out on the counter. You know, it's not easy to get those winemakers to agree on what to do, but we did something no one had ever done. And that was to work together as winemakers to figure out how to make an Oregon Solidarity wine.
Yeah.
As a fundraiser for the damaged Rogue Valley growers, with the net proceeds going back to those growers. So we paid for the grapes in cash so they'd have the money for their mortgages, and then we covered with the net proceeds money to support the Rogue Valley vendors. Anyway, I want to thank Senator Merkley, because he then not only followed through on helping those growers with the disaster relief that they needed, but also with the research that we needed. I mean, these fires are a serious matter. There is smoke taint, but in the particular case, frankly, a very large California winery uses as an excuse to back out of those the grape picks. That's really what happened. We made over 7,500 cases of Oregon Solidarity wine. We still have some left. So you can get some of this delicious wine made by the winemakers here in the Willamette Valley. It's been a privilege to work with you, Senator, and your staff. And it's an example of the values that we all hold dear, and we've got each other's back. So thank you.
So I think the Chardonnay is sold out, and you had a rosé, I think, as well. Is that it's gone? So what's the Pinot Noir?
Pinot Noir.
It's still available. And can people get that online?
Yes, and there's a number of stores that sell this wine. Roth sells it, Safeway sells it, Fred Meyer. You'll find this in a number of locations.
Excellent.
And you can call us.
Okay.
It's delicious.
So just as a way of recognizing and celebrating this work, and I just love the words, Oregon Solidarity. This time where there's so many divisive forces coming together as a community to solve a challenge. It's just a beautiful thing. So to recognize that, this is a flag for you to use in appropriate fashion that has been flown over the U.S. Capitol. Thank you very much.
It's labeled Oregon Solidarity and has the signatures of the winemakers on the back label. I failed to mention one other thing. Our industry has a Nobel Prize, essentially, that is awarded in our industry. And this wine, this project, was recognized by our industry, receiving the Wine Star Award for Innovation.
So much going on. But let's start by talking about the challenge we're facing with the coronavirus. We do have a couple healthcare experts here who can answer more detailed questions as they come up in the town hall. But I just wanted to give you some general sense. We are, by the way, I think we're Facebooking this. We're Facebooking this if I stay in the right spot, so to be seen. So people could participate without coming to a town hall if they felt uncomfortable doing so. What we're facing, you might think of it a little bit like the equivalent of a scary flu season. And we're in person-to-person contact. The disease moves, and it moves through people coughing or sneezing, and you proceed to have it on your hands from a handrail or who knows what, and you put your hand to your nose or your mouth, and then you get infected. So that's why there's so much emphasis right now on really trying to cut transmission, which is why I'm trying to be disciplined. And you saw I just forgot just now. I almost shook hands with Jim, and he reminded me. It really helps to wash your hands, to use hand sanitizer, to consciously try not to put your hands to your face. And those things interrupt the infections. We do have several new cases in Oregon that were just announced this morning. We had 3 cases now. I think we have a total of 7. And some of those are from travel, and one is from person-to-person contact. We'll learn more about them. We are seeing the numbers go up very rapidly, and that's very scary. We had a briefing on Thursday morning with the Secretary Azar and the top health professionals. And at that briefing, they said, well, we now have 120 identified cases. Well, here we are on Saturday morning, 2 days later, we have more than 300 identified cases. If you went back 7 days ago, we had 26 identified cases. So 26, 120, 300. Now, a good part of that is that test kits are being now moved throughout the country to try to get test kits everywhere. So we're testing people we weren't testing before. So it doesn't mean this disease is moving that fast. Partly it means the test kits are getting distributed and we're testing more people. Most people who are younger, with healthy immune systems, will see very mild symptoms. It's disease is the sort of thing that attacks people who have particular health care challenges with an immune system, or lung issues, or are older and more frail and fragile. So in that sense, it's kind of similar to the way the flu is. Now the flu, think about the flu. Since 2010, we've had bad flu seasons and light flu seasons. In a light flu season, 14,000 Americans die from the flu. That's a significant number. In a heavy flu season, more than 60,000 die. We don't know how this will be proportional to that. I asked on Thursday morning, what is our best guess on the lethality of this disease? And one expert gave one answer, and then another expert stood up and said, no, that's not right at all. That doesn't take into account all the people who are infected who have mild symptoms. And he thought that the lethality best guess would be equivalent to flu or perhaps up to 10 times worse. That's still significant variation, so we don't know. But the point is, we're trying to break the chain of communication or of flu from one person or the coronavirus from one person to another being very thoughtful about our hands. It comes down to our hands. That's that. There are so many other issues around the nation. I'll just mention a few of them. We have the challenge of investments in the foundations for families to thrive, issues related to health care, to housing, to education, to living wage jobs. We have the challenge of really erosion of the credibility of our institutions and our election system, gerrymandering, voter suppression, intimidation breaking out in all kinds of ways, and then dark money in campaigns that has been unleashed by the Citizens United decision a few years ago. There is a bill to take this on called the For the People Act. Senator Udall from New Mexico and I are the leads of this in the Senate. We have 47 co-sponsors. We'd like to have 100 co-sponsors protecting the integrity of our election system. This bill, by the way, has passed the House. It was in the House known as H.R. 1. So if you've heard of H.R. 1, it's the For the People Act. We have certainly the challenge of carbon pollution and trying to take on challenges. We see so many challenges of that in Oregon. I'll address that more if people raise the issue. But it's very important that we quickly move towards a renewable energy economy. So those are just a few of the issues. I really want to leave this time for you all to raise what's on your mind. I think the mayor has agreed to mix up all those tickets that you got on the way in, make sure everybody has an equal chance of asking a question or making a point. If someone's making a point that you completely, passionately disagree with, please be doubly respectful of that individual. Let them have their say. You know, the tradition of town halls is disappearing across America. But here with the Oregon way of listening to each other, we've maintained it. In fact, I think it's thriving in our state. Both Senator Wyden and I do a town hall in every county every year, plus a whole lot of other public panels and so forth. In addition, and that in the friction that we have in our nation, kind of the tribal friction that maybe between parties or between urban and rural, other folks across the country have given up on the town halls. Let's double down on the communication in town halls and listening to each other and respecting each other in the different positions that might be shared. So with that, let's turn to tickets. And these tickets, these white tickets, they almost all start with 590. I think they all start with 590. So I am not going to read the first three numbers because you get all excited. Oh, 590, that's my, no. I'll just read the last three numbers on the right. And just raise your hand, and then we'll ask you to tell us your number and your name. 222-226 and 236. Just raise your hand if you have any of those. Yes, right up here. We'll get you started, and then right here, this is the front row. Okay, we'll come to you next. And tell us your name and your number, please.
I'm Marvin Salas, 222. I grew up in Mount Angel, 3 miles from there. Played ball right over here at St. Luke's. Anyway, what I want to ask about is the war, Senator. We are bombing 8 countries this morning. We have siege warfare with eight countries. That's more than half of the discretionary budget is spent on these foreign wars. We have Tulsi Gabbard will be on Oregon's ballot. She's the first anti-war candidate we've had since Robert Kennedy in 1968. Why don't you guys ever talk about the damn war? We have, Trump has dropped an average of 44,000 bombs a year for 3 years. Now, I think you guys don't talk about it because Obama dropped 20,000 bombs a year for 8 years. And he won a Nobel Peace Prize for doing it. So what in the hell is going on? Why don't we talk about where we're spending most of our money? Thank you.
Thank you, and I see you have some Tulsi handouts there, if anyone might to get more information in your pocket. I think this is a really big issue. And let me touch on a couple pieces of it. The first is that I think we made some really big mistakes in our strategy. With Afghanistan, I think we should have destroyed the training centers where people were being trained to be terrorists. But we shouldn't have tried to occupy the country and turn it into a Western democracy. We've lost thousands of lives, $1 trillion, huge number of injuries that will haunt American soldiers for the rest of their lifetimes. And that occupation hasn't produced anything that looks like a Western democracy, nor was that really possible. I think about one of Rudyard Kipling's poems about the British soldier being rejected by the tribes in Afghanistan, and it ends with kind of a graphic paragraph that speaks to the fact that the soldiers were not well, the British soldiers were not well accepted. And would you like to hear that?
Yeah.
Okay, like I said, it's pretty graphic. Let's see if I can remember it. It's, if you find yourself wounded on the Afghanistan plane, roll over on your rifle and blow out your brains before the women come out and carve up what remains. So pretty graphic. Every group that has gone into Afghanistan has left, not changing the basic tribal character. In Iraq, the non-existent weapons of mass destruction that we went in, Iraq was a very stable counterpart to Iran, a vicious dictator for sure, but we went under false pretenses and we created chaos that is now haunting us, and it's also thousands of lives lost, trillions of dollars, or $1 trillion lost, and many, many injuries. So this shows one thing that I think we need to emphasize, which is any decision to go to war needs to abide with our Constitution, which says that decision is too big an issue to be made by a single person in the Oval Office, that it needs to come to Congress, and there has to be an authorization by Congress, and then that authorization needs to be followed. Now, the Afghanistan authorization, it did come from Congress, but it was very narrow. It said, those who attacked us on 9/11 and those who harbor those who attacked us. That has been stretched now to justify action in, well, a lot of nations. I think it's actually more than 8. Then we have the 2002 for Iraq, and it was very, very narrow and precise regarding that particular situation with the believed weapons of mass destruction. And that's now being used by administration to say that would justify war in Iran. And so I put forward a provision with others that says, Mr. President, no, these authorizations do not justify war in Iran. You have to come to Congress to get authorization. That's what the Constitution says, and we need to follow the Constitution. So that's my position. I'll just say, in terms of our military budget, I spent a couple years working for Secretary Weinberger, there's massive waste in our military budget, and quite frankly, we're falling behind other nations, other developed nations, on our infrastructure, on our education, on our investment in housing, which we see big impact on, and I do think we need to move billions and billions of dollars from the defense enterprise and cut out a lot of that waste and duplication and move it into healthcare and housing and education and infrastructure. Did we have 226 or 236? Yes, right over here.
I just wanted to know.
Your number and name, please.
226. I'm from Mount Angel. And my name is Pat. And I just wanted to know, all the things that Trump has done, all the turnovers, the Clean Water, the Dreamers, the forestry, and what he's saying about the virus and everything else. And he's put in all this money for our budget. Does he get to keep all that? Or is somebody able to turn over our Clean Water Act and our Dreamers and our immigration and our...
This is a very, very broad question you're asking.
It's the crux
pretty much everything. Let me just take one piece of it philosophically. which is the president cannot operate outside the laws established by Congress, but there's a lot of room for flexibility in regulation. And then if the strategy and vision in the Constitution is a system of checks and balances, that Congress can obtain witnesses and documents to be able to say, okay, is what you're doing in accordance with law or not. That check and balance is now in dire concern. There is a case called the McGahn case where Congress issued a subpoena, and the lower court has said, yeah, you can't subpoena the executive branch. Well, if you can't get documents and witnesses, you can't do oversight, and it would just absolutely gut the accountability to law that the Constitution envisions. Our founders were very, very concerned about presidents kind of thinking back to the pre-colonial, the kingdoms in Europe, and we'll have a president tempted to be a king. The whole way to prevent that was to have congressional oversight to keep people within the law. So I'm very concerned about the erosion of that. And so I'm going to use that as a way to try to answer your question, that we have to, hopefully we'll see this is going to be appealed to the Supreme Court, or it has been appealed. I'm certainly hoping that congressional oversight is sustained by the Supreme Court, because if there's anything that's core to the Constitution, it's this check and balance. If we lose this case, then we're really in the world of an imperial presidency, which is not at all what the founders or our Constitution envisions. And we're in real trouble. They were in real trouble, now we're in more trouble than that. Thank you. And did we have the final one, 236? Yes. And I'm going to read on deck 224, 221, and 241. So if you have any of those, we'll get to you in a moment.
So 236, I'm Marcos Sanchez, the president of Chemeca Students for Life, and the Oregon State Captain for Students for Life Action. Last week, you voted against cloture on the motion to proceed with the Born Alive Abortion Survivors Protection Act. This legislation would have effectively criminalized infanticide nationwide, require abortionists to provide life-saving care to babies born alive, and ensure surviving infants get admitted to a hospital. Can you please explain your vote and tell us what is currently happening to those babies who are being born alive after a failed abortion?
So we already have laws against infanticide. This bill was put forward as a campaign strategy, and it goes to the heart of whether Uncle Sam is the right force to be making healthcare decisions with a doctor and a woman. And I believe that you have very challenging situations that come about in a later term abortion. You have an individual who wanted to carry a baby to term, but then terrible things develop in the health of the baby or the health of the mother. And those are extraordinarily challenging, and I think the right way to resolve them is between a woman, her partner, her religious advisor, minister, and her doctor. And that the federal government is absolutely not the right presence to insert into the exam room, and that's why I voted against that bill. I'll leave that to healthcare experts to take that one on. 241, 221, and 224.
Hello, I'm Sam. First off, I really love the job you've done. You're really awesome. We need more seconds like you. I really do sincerely appreciate what you've done. My question is about the 2005 bankruptcy bill. I hate to say it, but Joe Biden kind of ran through with, and then it was signed into law by Bush and all the Republicans. You're familiar with it. The law that outlawed discharging private student loan debt for the first time in the history of our country, right? My wife, my daughter, and I collectively have $500,000 in student loan debt. that's, you heard that right, $500,000. Wells Fargo and Bank of America and Key Bank are never going to get that money. They could hold a gun to my head and it wouldn't make a damn bit of difference. I'm going to work until I drop dead and they can dig up my corpse from the grave. Take my rings off and see what they can sell, and I'm all for it. Like, go ahead. Take my teeth out. You know. I'm being serious now. Now that it looks like the erasure of student loan debt is probably not going to happen because of current events, you know, in the primary. Would you please, 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 please work to overturn that law, please? I'm not the only one. Hardly. There's millions of people just like me. And it has killed my daughter's life. It's me and my wife are going to go. We're both over 60 now. This is our life. Can you help out, please?
How many folks have student loan debt? How many of you have family members who are concerned about student loan debt? Quite a lot. It's a very big deal. You know, when I got out of high school, if you worked minimum wage for the summer and you lived at home, ate out of the fridge, you could pay tuition at an Oregon public university. Mm-hmm. Try doing that today. We're in a whole different world. And yet, the economy has more and more pathways that demand a college education. We should promote every pathway to success in terms of training and the skills, the apprenticeship programs, all of the trades that don't require college, but many require college. And so other countries are investing in education so that their citizens do not have college loan debt. They aren't all free, although in Germany, tuition is pretty close to free. So I think we have to at least move to a debt-free opportunity at our public universities. We have now, in Oregon, for folks coming out of high school, created and I salute our state legislators for doing this, created a pathway to aid. Joe motioning to Teresa. They've created a pathway out of high school to go to where I think it costs $50 a credit in your first 2 years at a community college. That's a great step forward. It makes no sense at all to have people view higher education as going to produce debt the size of a home mortgage that's going to constrain you your entire life. And I live in a blue-collar community on the outskirts of Portland. That community, people tell me, I'm not sure I should encourage my kids to go to college because they may end up with this type of debt. That is not an aspirational opportunity for all society. We talk about the American dream and the vision that everyone has an opportunity to thrive and do well, but to do that, you have to have a lot of well-paved road for people to travel. Now, there's an American journalist who comes from Oregon, Nicholas Kristof,
yes,
and he's just written a book called Tightrope, and it's about how that road has become so narrow and jagged, it's more like trying to write to walk a tightrope, and you fall off. And he documents how his community of Ann Hill, Oregon, has seen this in spades. For everyone who has debt, I think they should be able to refinance that 6, 8, 10% debt to the same rate the big banks get when they borrow from the federal government, which is
right.
Like 1%.
Right.
We need to vastly increase the Pell Grants.
Yes.
And then we need to enable there to be enough financial aid so that people can go to a public university equivalent debt-free. So they can thrive in their lives. They can buy houses, which people can't do now because that debt hangs over. You know, homeownership took a really bad hit in 2008, 2009 because of the predatory mortgages. I took on the task of getting rid of those mortgages when I went to the U.S. Senate, succeeded. I had passed a bill in the Oregon House when I was Speaker to get rid of those predatory mortgages. The Oregon Senate didn't act. But when I went to the Senate, I started talking about this, and Senator Dodd said, come to the Banking Committee. I want to put you in the Banking Committee. Lead this charge. Get rid of these predatory mortgages. And I did. So we don't have those triple options. We don't have those negative amortizing. We don't have those exploding interest rate mortgages anymore. But what we do have is student debt. That means people can't qualify for mortgages. And we also have prices so high people can't afford to buy them. But they are the major driver of middle class wealth. So instead of having $500,000 in student debt, it'd be great to have $500,000 in equity. That puts you in a whole different position. And that's the type of change we have to make here in the United States of America. We have 221 and 241.
Hello, Senator. I have 241. My name is George Newyear. I'm out of Monmouth. I'd like to ask you a little bit more regarding checks and balances. Between our three branches, those checks and balances have had a lot of tradition and norm based into keeping them upright. What statute would you like to see added to it? Maybe you could talk a little bit about what's in HR 1 or any traditions or norms that you think aren't cutting it.
Okay, well, thank you for the invitation to talk about the HR 1, the For the People Act. So here is something to ponder. If you look at the distribution of wealth in America, we're back in the Gilded Age. Huge concentration at the top. Over the last four decades, our national wealth has grown enormously, but not for working people. Working people, incomes have been flat or declining. That wealth at the top becomes very powerful and can overwhelm the machinery of a democratic republic. By that I mean the most powerful individuals can have huge panels of lawyers who litigate everything and push everything. They can hire lobbyists. The drug industry has, I haven't fact checked this, so I say that out loud because I keep meaning to do so, so I'll register it for my team, that there are five drug lobbyists for every member of Congress. And then you have the money in the campaigns, and then you have the money in the media campaigns, and then you have the money behind the social media campaigns, and then you have the money that goes to the ownership of media. So all of this can result in a tipping point where even despite the machinery of elections, the powerful make laws to make the rich richer. And we saw this in 2017 with a tax bill that gave $2 trillion away almost entirely to the richest Americans. What would happen if we get those $2 trillion back and invest it in housing and healthcare and education and infrastructure here in the United States of America? So we have to take on the things that have happened that have twisted the machinery of government. One is gerrymandering. So the bill, or the people bill, would say there have to be independent commissions across the land. And those have worked pretty well, for example, in Pennsylvania, to take a highly gerrymandered state and make it reflect the distribution of viewpoints in that state. A second is the essentially restoring the Voting Rights Act and utilizing the experiences we have from Oregon so that it would guarantee automatic voter registration, early voting, paper ballots that can be recounted by Oregonians. It would stop polling place manipulation, so you had to have staffing equivalent at each polling station according to the population of that precinct. So you couldn't have short lines in precincts you favor politically and 6-hour lines in ones you don't. It takes on all those issues. And I think Oregon is the national leader in this. If we could just copy the Oregon system, it would stop a huge amount of the voter intimidation and manipulation, including stopping the purging of voting rolls in a partisan fashion, which happened in Georgia and other states, and it's completely biasing the outcome of elections. So that's the second. The third big one is the money and how it flows. There's so much dark money, hundreds of millions of dollars flowing through these campaigns. You see these ads by groups like Generation Opportunity and so forth that you don't know who's behind. You don't know, you can't track the money. It's like a shell game. It goes from this to this to this to this to this. You can't tell what the original donors were, and even if you could, you couldn't track where the money ended up. And so it takes on, it shines a light and gets rid of the shell game strategy of hiding the path of money. So we can't actually overturn Citizens United, which says unlimited sums by billionaires into campaigns, but we can in fact shine a light so we can see where every dime comes from. So that would be a huge improvement. And then it has an ethics section to reduce the conflicts of interest. And so I think passing that, I'd like to see that passed in January 2021. And I hope it gets 100 votes in the U.S. Senate. And it raises an issue about the Senate because of the fact that the lobby absolutely does not want that to pass. They have tremendous power the way things are. And one of those powers is the supermajority in the Senate. I've watched the Senate lose two key items over my working lifetime from the time I was first interning for Senator Hatfield and working for Congress in the 80s. And one of those was the ability to put any issue on the floor as a senator. So you could force a debate and a vote on all kinds of things that make powerful lobbies uncomfortable because they don't want them debated, they don't want them voted. That's gone. There were virtually no amendments last year, virtually no bills last year. The second is that the Senate has, for our history, been a simple majority in virtually all circumstances as the founders envisioned, and it's become now a supermajority. That gives tremendous power to the lobby to stop things when they need a smaller number of people to vote against taking on. It's why we haven't taken on background checks. It's why we haven't taken on the high cost of drugs, is in part this supermajority in the Senate. Hamilton said, don't do this, and he used language like, you will see by this being supermajority, tedious delays and contemptuous compromises of the common good. Madison said, do not let the will of majority be bent to the will of minority. It undermines the very premise of our democratic republic. So we have now made the very mistake the founders warned us against. We have to correct that mistake and return the Senate to being a legislative body that can debate and can vote and can address the problems we see all across America. And if none, we will go quickly. Yes, right here.
My name is Barbara Wynn. 219 is my
name. 219, thank you.
My question is, of the hundreds of bills that the Senate majority party will not allow to be voted on that have come to the Senate from the House, name some other priority bills besides the ones you've already talked about.
Well, these 350 bills, they cover the spectrum. But let me shine a light on a couple that we haven't talked about. One is the Equality Act. The Equality Act comes out of Oregon. When I was speaker here in Oregon, we passed the Equality Act that said we're going to use the foundation of the 64 Civil Rights Act, and we're going to say that every person has an opportunity to employment, to jury duty, to mortgages, as everyone else. No more door slamming because people are LGBT individuals. Everyone gets to participate in our society. So that bill, we passed in Oregon, and then Ted Kennedy asked me to lead the battle for the Employment Non-Discrimination Act because he was sick and dying of cancer. I led that battle. We passed that bill in the Senate. The House didn't take it up, and it died. And then I worked with others to take the Oregon Equality Act and create the National Equality Act, which has now passed the House of Representatives, and it has not been taken up in the Senate. Isn't it time we ended discrimination across our country against the LGBTQ community? Yes. Gave the full opportunity. And the climate carbon bills to facilitate the transition to renewable energy. Then there's a host of those that have died. We have massive subsidies to the fossil fuel industry. I'll tell you, so I guess it's 2 years ago, there was a bill to kill research into wind energy because Senator from Tennessee really hates wind turbines. I talked to a senator from Grassley, from Iowa. There's a lot of wind there. And I said, would you partner with me? We'll have a bipartisan stand for research into renewable wind energy. And he said, absolutely. So we go to the floor, and Senator Lamar Alexander from Tennessee stands up and says, we don't need this because this is a mature industry, and why should we subsidize research on a mature industry? And I stood up and said, Well, first of all, wind technology is changing dramatically, very different now than 5 years ago. If we do research, it'll be very different 5 years forward. There's all kinds of new potential. And so this is where research is needed. Meanwhile, if we want to cancel subsidies into a mature industry, how about canceling subsidies into a 150-year-old industry called the fossil fuel industry? Senator Grassley and I won. And so score one for renewable energy. But there's so many bills that have died in that sector. Okay, we have 229 and 235. Yes. Thanks.
Senator Merkley, I come to you as a Clinkett woman. We have over 1,100 tribal members here in the Portland metro area and Alaska. But I come to you regarding the VAWA bill, Violence Against Women's Act bill, and how they're trying to reclassify what's the domestic violence and stuff that's going on. And I understand you have worked strongly with Senator Murkowski out of Alaska regarding some of these issues. So I wanted to know what's happening, especially with the senator out of Ohio who's wanting to rewrite it, reclassify everything under the current executive administration. It would put a lot of us at risk.
Yeah, so the last renewal of this Violence Against Women Act, we took on two big issues, violence against tribal women and violent domestic violence and stalking. And we're now trying to renew it again because it's, I think it was a 5-year bill, the 5 years have passed, and it's being blocked by the Senate leadership. So I don't have a lot more details for you. We're so appreciative of Senator Murkowski's leadership, but we don't have a critical mass. When I said almost no bills have been on the floor, this is really an example. Like, shouldn't we at least debate it? Shouldn't we at least have to vote on it? Shouldn't we have to be accountable to our voters for where we stand on it? None of that happens if it doesn't come to the floor of the Senate. So I think we would win if it came to the floor of the Senate, but think about this structural problem. The Senate was designed with no constitutional leader except presiding vice president, who in practice doesn't actually preside, had no power over the rules. The idea was distributed power among the 100. But under the recent changes in the abuse of the privilege of the majority leader, not a constitutional position, leader of the majority party in the Senate, takes the privilege to be the first called on for an amendment or the first called on for a motion to completely blockade bills from coming to the floor or from amendments from coming to the floor. That is not distributed power among 100. That is a concentration of power that is absolutely destroying the Senate as a legislative body. One can agree or disagree with the work of the Oregon House, but I can tell you, you can go down when all the members attend, and they will proceed to debate on the floor 5 to 15 bills in an afternoon evening. Is that an exaggeration? Am I exaggerating?
A tiny bit?
What's the most bills in your experience that you've debated and voted on in an afternoon and evening?
Well, it really depends on the size of the bill, right?
It does.
And if we decide to read the bill, so...
Okay, well, there's another delay tactic of reading every word, right?
Yeah, exactly. So they vary. So we may be able to go through, in some days we can go through 5, some days we can go through, you're right, maybe 10 or 15.
Thank you very much.
Nothing about it, yes, no, you're right, nothing about it.
You used to go to the floor with all these bill folders, and you're reading each one, and then you're reading the next one, and you're trying to catch up on who says what, and what issue, and people change their opinions, because they're on the floor. You have to be within 30 seconds of the floor in order to vote. So people go, oh, well, that's a good point, I hadn't considered that. And people make motions, return it to committee. There's the possibility of doing a minority report, which is a form of amendment on the floor. And in fact, I was coming through the floor about a week and a half ago, I think it was, and there was a minority report that won and modified the bill. I know that that's pretty rare, but it happened while I happened to be there. But you do not see anything like that in the Senate. those words that used to describe the U.S. Senate, the world's greatest deliberative body, it is now like the world's least deliberative legislative body. It's when I wrestled with running for re-election, I felt the only way I'm running for re-election is if I just fight like hell to try to restore the Senate to being a legislative body where people's bills can, and amendments can be on the floor, we can vote, we can be held accountable to the people of the United States of America.
My name is Steve Wynn. I live in Kaiser. My name is Steve Wynn. I live in Kaiser. Well, I grew up in Woodburn through high school. I guess my question is a little closer to home. I see a lot of farmland. There's some really excellent farmland in this area. Just on the other side of the railroad tracks on the left, there's a subdivision of some of the best farmland in the Willamette Valley. I'm wondering what we can do to protect farmland from development. Once developed, it rarely goes back to any other use.
Could you all catch that? What are we doing to protect farmland from development? So it's very interesting that you should raise this question, because Oregon has probably the strongest law in the nation to protect farmland in terms of our urban growth boundaries. I'm suspecting this must be land that was brought into the urban growth boundary. Is that? You're not sure?
I just know that just on the other side of the railroad tracks.
Okay. So going back to Tom McCall said we don't want to become overrun with development and sprawl like California, so we'll create an urban growth boundary, kind of a virtual wall around each city, and those who have land outside that wall will get a special low tax rate, and that's forest and farmland, but they won't be able to put developments on it. And those inside the urban growth boundary, as long as they're still farming it and keeping it as farmland, will still keep that low tax rate until they decide to sell it for development. So that has really constrained sprawl in Oregon and protected farmland and forest land compared to other states. I don't know if you know that particular piece of land, but I'm guessing, the mayor, do you know the answer? Do you want to tackle that? No, okay. Put you on the spot.
Yeah. Right? I'll be so much about that particular piece of property. It's just the idea in general.
Well, and so in general, so we had an initiative that was very misleading, and it destroyed our urban growth boundary strategy. And when I was speaker in 2007, we worked to craft an initiative to go back to the people, or referral, to say, do we want to save our land use system with the virtual wall and the protection of forest and farmland? And we won that pretty overwhelmingly at the ballot place. So it's still in place. If it's outside the urban growth boundary, it can't be developed. It has to stay as farmland or forest land. If it's inside, it could be developed, but there's an incentive to keep it in farmland as long as the owner wants to keep farming, because they keep that low tax rate as if they were outside. So that's the basic answer. And when people come to Oregon from states all over the country, they come to study our urban growth system. And when you drive out of the urban growth boundary and suddenly the housing just stops, they go, well, how did that happen? Well, it's because of this being in place. Well, I'm told we're out of time. I know I had read two more numbers, and so I hate to cut off anyone after I've read the numbers. And either of those two numbers, if somebody want to speak quickly.
228,
okay, and we have 228 and 2934. So you can be very brief, and I'll try to be very brief.
I will. Do you support the use of superdelegates to support to determine the next Democratic nominee?
Question is, in the Democratic convention, the use of superdelegates, I supported taking away the voting power of superdelegates in the first round. Nobody thought it would ever get to the second round. I don't think it will. And so I weighed in to take away the superdelegates vote. In the first
round. Round or one?
For the first round. It's very unlikely we'll ever get to a second.
Maybe.
Well, this time people think maybe, but if you look at the numbers now that the Democratic side is down to two viable candidates, it's almost impossible that it would go to a second round.
Then may I ask you a follow-up question?
Well, as long as it's not too political, because this is a bipartisan community gathering, but go ahead.
Would you support
Joe Biden, should he be the Democratic nominee?
Yeah, that's too political.
Yeah.
No, but you know, I mean, it's obvious that I've said this many times publicly. In this context, and I apologize to our Republicans who are here, it's more of a party question than a community question. But I'm a Democrat, and I'll be at the acting, whoever our nominee is. But I don't want to get more into the Democratic-Republican side of this in this setting. So I know it was, you had the last one. Okay, yes.
I'm 227, but I have a question about the detainees, about those.
So you have a number that was not called, right?
Yes, I have a number that wasn't called.
What do you think, folks? Should we now?
That's letter.
I have a question about the detainees that are crammed together, you know, 60 to a cell that's supposed to hold 12, that are sleeping on cold concrete, that are getting frozen burritos. How many of them have coronavirus that we're not being told about? How many are ill and how many have died that they're covering up? That's what I want to know.
I haven't heard of any reports of coronavirus among you're speaking of refugees. There's almost no cases reported in Mexico so far. There are far more in Canada than in Mexico. So that's the best information I have on it at this point. Wherever you have people concentrated together, though, like with flu, if there is a case, it would spread very easily, very, very quickly. And we have to absolutely be on guard in old folks' homes, in prisons, in any sort of setting where people are jammed together. So I'll just close by thanking you all for coming out. And to those, I don't know how many are out there on Facebook, but if you're out there and you're watching on Facebook, thank you for attending that fashion. We all are going to see a change. There's a convention next weekend in Austin, Texas that was just canceled. There's going to be other things that are canceled because people are a little concerned about coming out into public. So thank you all for saying this matters. You wanted to be here. You are here. I want to really thank our representative for her work and for our mayor, for emceeing, much appreciated. I am looking at the flag at the other end. United we stand. And how about we have a little less division, maybe a lot less division, and a lot more the sense that we're coming together as Americans to build a more successful, a more beautiful, and a more prosperous nation together. Thank you.